First up for speakers is Representative Dylan Bates from Westbrook, who's one of our youngest legislators, and he's going to talk to us about the GMO bill.
Right. Okay. I can try to handle two mics at once. Hi, everyone.
Hello.
Look at all these beautiful people out here in support of, you know, common sense and food and good things like that. First of all, I just wanted to say thank you. I realize, and we all realize, how very difficult, I'm gonna move the mic, how very difficult it is to take time out of your day to come out and do this. I know that you all have lives, you have jobs, you have commitments, but to come down and truly make this a representative democratic process is fantastic. So thank you for being here. Thank you. Yes. Yes. Give yourself a round. I also wanted to give a quick shout out to the brilliant sponsor of this bill, Representative Michelle Dunphy out of Old Town, who brought forward this very important issue. So if we can give her a little love, that would be appreciated.
Thank you.
This has been an issue that so many people have worked on for so very, very long, and between us, it's about damn time. So, what I wanted to say here today, just a couple of comments. You'll forgive me if I have the script in my hand. I'll go off it soon enough. But we're here today as representatives from all corners of the state because we share many things, including, but not limited to, common sense. So, we're here because we believe that there's a fundamental human right to know what's in our food. We owe it to our communities, to our families, to ourselves, to know what we're ingesting, to be aware of what we're ingesting. And it's so very common sense that it's hard to imagine this even being a political issue. So what I wanted to talk about really quickly is the concept that this is a political issue. And perhaps the biggest politics involved would be due to shady practices, political arm twisting, and a number of corporations that have gradually chipped away at our ability to know what's in our food, and then framing our attempt to get it back as a legitimate debate. So, we understand there's a right to know what's in our food.
Use the mic.
Okay, thank you. We understand that there's a right to know what's in our food, but we also need to realize that this is such a very recent debate in the course of human history. For the vast majority of human history, this has not even been a concept that we would fathom. We've either foraged, gathered, farmed, purchased, traded our food, and made it ourselves, and as a result, known what was in it. It's only recently that this has become an issue, and it's time that we address it. What I wanted to say, I'd like to use a couple of quotes from our friend and famous politician, former Governor Jesse the Body Ventura. Believe it or not, he even realized this was a problem. He stated publicly in an address that, quote, "Monsanto can do anything they want to you. They can put anything they want to in your foods, and there's absolutely nothing you can do about it." Long before that, an arguably more eloquent gentleman and statesman named Mark Twain had the quote that, "In this country, we continue to have the best government that money can buy." So, on this issue, we're fighting not the public, we're fighting money, we're fighting interests, and it's finally now that the tide is turning. So today, this is in your hands. Democracy is truly represented in its absolute purest form when you, the citizens, come to express your desires and your opinions to the legislature, and we thank you for it. The Court of Public Opinion has already spoken on this issue. In the most recent poll I read, it has 97% public support. Which is pretty cool. So after hours and days and months, and for many of you, years of advocacy on this issue, I wanted to say thank you for sticking to it, and finally people are starting to come on board. We are also in a time where, for the first time really since their inception of Agent Orange, the word Monsanto has become socially considered a dirty word. And that's a big, big deal. So, when we go in today, I want you to use this. I'm going to be done with the script. What I'd like you to do is I want you to use your passion, use your knowledge, and use your personal experience to inform the decisions of our government, which is exactly how it's supposed to be. We're rooting for you. You will find that you have more allies than you know. Many that can't be here today. Many who will be behind the horseshoe in the committee room. Advocate not only for yourselves and your families, but for everybody else here. And advocate for the people that couldn't make it here today. This is a communal issue. We need to win it. We will win it. And I think our time is now. And I'm going to let the next speaker talk. So thank you, guys.
Okay, next on our speaker list is Jonathan Emmert, and I'm told that he's going to introduce himself, because they didn't give me any notes to introduce him with, so he gets to introduce himself. Here he is.
Hello. Thank you so much for coming out. It's good to see the number of people here assembled, and you know, for every one person who's here, there are probably hundreds that are thinking the same thing and want to be here, but can't be. For one reason or another. But, need more sound? How about that? Loud enough? Can you hear me? Okay. I'm an attorney who practices constitutional and administrative law before the state and federal courts, and I am one of the principal authors of the Vermont GMO labeling bill. Your bill is substantially indistinguishable from the Vermont bill. And the Connecticut bill is likewise very similar. You know, the industry, principally Monsanto and the Grocery Manufacturers Association, they all want you to believe that non-disclosure of information you consider important is in your best interest. Now, this goes against basic economics. If you believe in a free market, you understand that accurate information is indispensable to informed consumer choice. We can't exercise consumer choice intelligibly in the food market unless we know what we're buying. And there is an interesting contradiction in the argument that is made by those who advocate non-disclosure, that is, deception. And that argument is that We have engineered a product that is better than nature. We can end famine. We can end pestilence. We can transform the globe. We will save the earth with genetically modified ingredients. Well, if you're so proud of your ingredients and you're so very convinced that genetic engineering is superior, why not be honest and tell us the foods that contain it? Shouldn't you be able to convince us, as is true with every commercial promotion, that your product, truthfully advertised, is better than nature? Why not take on that issue? No. They don't want you to know these superior foods. They don't want you to know what they are. They want you to guess. If they're right that the foods are superior, or that they're indistinguishable from natural foods, then why not tell us? There's an interesting concept in the First Amendment, which is fundamental, and that is that there is no First Amendment right on the part of the government to suppress truthful information. Government can't suppress truthful information. But likewise, as is true of that doctrine, which is underlined by the notion that you need to have accurate information in the market for consumers to make informed choices and to exercise their will and their preference and not waste their dollars, you must also be truthful in what you sell. We call it fraud when a person intentionally deceives you, when they cause you to expend money for something that you didn't intend to buy. If I'm selling you peas, and I'm Monsanto, and I don't tell you that I've genetically engineered your peas, and you're an organic consumer, you may well read the label and say, oh, thank goodness, it's just peas and salt. I'll buy that. You have been deceived. When government doesn't act to protect the consumer's right to know, when government stands in the way of truthful information in the market, government condones deception, becomes a party to it, promotes it. They talk about the economic cost of changing a label. Changing a label to include those few words is absolutely so limited in its economic effect that it's indistinguishable from normal everyday business. They won't even take it into account as an increase in expense. But the economic expense to millions of people of being deceived is enormous. The dislocation in the market is profound. When Chipotle thinks it's buying organic pork and discovers after years of selling it to consumers as organic pork that it actually was genetically engineered, many people have been harmed. Chipotle, consumers, those throughout the chain who depended upon it being organic, and many others. That's economic harm. When you spend your hard-earned dollars on goods that you think are organic when they're not, that's economic harm. It doesn't matter what causes you to freely choose something. That's your right. But what isn't legal in this country ordinarily is deception. If I hide material information from you to induce you to buy something on a false premise, I am deceiving you. That's what this industry wants to do. And they want to do it with the help of the state of Maine. And they're succeeding in doing it with the help of every other state. Now that begs the question, why should this particular bill, which would require immediate implementation of the labeling requirement, be passed as opposed to having contingencies that say, well, let's wait for other states to do this, or let's depend upon some other formula before we actually require it? Well, you don't wait for what is right. You don't condone deception for a minute. If you are a person of integrity, if you are a legislator of integrity, if you believe in the people of this state and you want to protect their interests, you will end deception as soon as you see it. You will not stand in defense of it. You will not be counted as a person who condones it. You will not be an industry hack. You will be a person of integrity who believes in the truth, who stands up at a moment when you're required to do it, and takes the step necessary to ensure that the people of this state are not deceived. It is a very basic thing. So that when you think next time at election time, whether your representative is with you or against you, you should remember whether he or she voted to deceive you. Who wants a person in office who's in favor of deception? None of us does. All right, well, that gets us back to today's event. I salute you all for being here. I urge you to make your voice loud and clear. I urge you to be factual in your presentations, but also to be mindful that these people listen to many things. They listen to numbers. They listen to the truth communicated by people, even if they don't want to hear it. And they also respect your conviction. I hope that this state will do the right thing. I hope the governor of this state will make up his mind to decide to favor this bill. This is a situation where Maine can lead. How many times do we want this state not to lead on a question that's right? Why not be the first state to take a dramatic step like this? We already have Vermont. There's a federal court that has decided that the First Amendment challenge in a summary judgment motion would fail. That was the correct decision. There's no constitutional obstacle to this bill. Let's do what's right.
Yes.
Best wishes to you.
Thank you, Dan.
Okay, well, we weren't sure that we were going to have words from the sponsor today, but we are. Representative Michelle Dunphy, hurrah, who sponsored this, taking the triggers off our GMO labeling bill. And she's going to give us a few words about the bill.
Thank you so much for being here. My name is Michelle Dunphy, and I represent District 122, which is Old Town and Indian Island. And I'm so grateful that you're all here. My bill whether you're here for my bill, which is LD 991, or the other bills today in the Agriculture Committee, it's going to be a great day. And I'm so happy to be part of it and have the opportunity to bring forward this legislation. And my bill removes the contiguous state language, and it also removes the sunset on the bill that was previously passed in the 126th legislature. So I feel, as I think you do, that the time is now. We don't want to wait. We want Maine to be a leader. We want labeling, and we want it now, and it's the right thing to do. And thank you. Thank you for the opportunity.
Thank you.
I was just, sorry, I was drawn away by Mr. Joel Salatin, who a lot of you have heard of. And he's going to give us a few words right now.
Hi, this is called... Yeah, it is. It is what it is. Yes, thank you. It's great to be here. It's great to see this kind of leverage. I wish we could just, I want to put you all in my luggage, bring you all down to Virginia. But there are people like us in Virginia, but Virginia's a bigger state and apparently has a little different pressures on it, not unlike yours. And I like the Monsanto sign here. That's good. So what we're here about today is ultimately, what does a society do to the weirdos who don't conform to the orthodoxy of the day? You know, the Romans had an axiom that said you can tell the strength of a society by the number of laws that it had, and that the weaker a society became, it made more laws because weak societies get very paranoid and fearful and concerned about the lunatic fringe. But if you read any business books, you know that all innovation comes from the lunatic fringe. You know, many of us that have been in this movement for a long time have felt. I know when the food police have showed up at our doorstep a couple times and confiscated and threatened and stamped and parked on our doorstep. You know, you feel like you're in a food inquisition. And some of you children here or young people, if you don't know what the Inquisition is, you need to study it a little bit. It's where they put heretics on the rack for not conforming to the orthodoxy of the day. Today, we have an orthodoxy. Our orthodoxy is that compost piles are really unsafe places because They're making babies. They're eating each other. Our compost piles up. That's a strange place. You know, a bag of chemical 10-10-10 is a lot safer. You know, we've got this orthodoxy that sterile food is safe food. You know, so if it's sterile, then you're okay. And so we get to the point where Mountain Dew and Coca-Cola are safe, but raw milk is unsafe because it's got bugs and enzymes in it. We wouldn't want to have enzymes. And we've had an orthodoxy that really people are too stupid to make food decisions. I mean, I've heard our people in Virginia, you know, the food police actually looked me in the eye and said, "Don't you understand? We cannot trust consumers to make food decisions. They don't know anything about food. You have to trust us." And of course, that's the ultimate orthodoxy, is trust it all to the experts. Well, we've given the orthodoxy free rein for a long time. You know, the orthodoxy told us to throw out butter and lard and use hydrogenated vegetable oil. The orthodoxy told us to sprinkle DDT in our kids' hair, you know, around the house. The orthodoxy told us in the late 1970s to eat a lot of carbohydrates on that big broad base of the food pyramid. Remember that? Eat more Twinkies and Cheerios. And the Orthodoxy told us to feed dead cows to our cows to make them grow faster, fatter, bigger, cheaper. And gave us bovine spongiform encephalopathy. The Orthodoxy told us to feed our animals antibiotics, you know, to keep them healthy and to put them in confinement houses. You know, I'm branded a bioterrorist by the farmers in our community because we let our chickens run out and commiserate with the red-winged blackbirds and indigo buntings, who then will take the diseases from our unvaccinated, unmedicated, undrugged chickens and threaten the planet's food supply by shutting down Tyson chicken houses with, you know, diseases. So this is the Orthodoxy of our day. And one of the big orthodoxies, too, is we shouldn't, as individuals, be in our kitchens. Kitchens are not where people want to be. You want to be out. You want to be out, you know, buying People magazine so you can keep up with the Kardashians. I mean, that's where people need to be. You got to be in front of your entertainment center. You got to be subscribing to Netflix. I mean, that's where the action is. And so if you actually want to get jazzed up and excited about domestic culinary arts and begin preserving, packaging, producing, processing food in your own kitchen, then you're a heretic and you can't be trusted. So anyway, I think this is a fundamental tension between the orthodoxy and the heretics, and so I encourage us all to proudly wear our heretic banner, because it's out of the lunatic fringe, the heretics, the weirdos, that all the answers to the orthodox problems come. So the truth is that our tribe, we heretics, we know how to raise food without Campylobacter, E. coli, Salmonella, Listeria, bovine spongiform encephalopathy, and all the other pathogens. I just stepped off the plane from Australia yesterday, and they've just had a hepatitis outbreak of Chinese berries. That's human sewage, by the way. I asked the folks in Australia, can you grow these berries? Well, I was in a room full of 100 farmers. Yeah, we can grow all the berries. We should be growing berries, exporting them to China. Why would we need to be importing berries from China? And so that's another orthodoxy of our day. You know, why should Maine grow something when you can get it cheaper from China or Peru or something? Orthodoxy of the day. The fact is that no community has ever sustained long-term survival when it can't feed itself. And that doesn't mean you can't have a banana or a cup of coffee every now and then, all right? It does mean that the backbone of food security is community security, which stems out of home centricity in our food system. And that comes finally down to personal choice among consenting adults to voluntarily choose the food of their choice from the source of their choice. I salute all of you. I'm proud of you, and I'm just honored to be here and to lend my voice to yours. You're carrying the weight here, and if I can help you in any way I can, I'm delighted and honored and privileged to be here with this great tribal groundswell where we take back the self-actualization, self-affirming freedoms that are so fundamental to the human spirit as to be able to choose the fuel for our 3 trillion member internal bacterial community. That is a very, very clear right. I say when the government gets between my mouth and my throat, that's an invasion of privacy.
Yeah.
So let's carry this on, and I trust that we will have victory very soon here on this effort in Maine. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Thank you for
making this trip up here to Maine to testify on this bill. This is so important. This is what the revolution looks like, folks. Next, we're going to have Catherine Paul from the Organic Consumers Association, who are have been the backers of the GMO, removing the trigger bill on the GMO labeling. Thanks. Hi, everybody. I'll make this brief. It's getting chilly out here. Really appreciate the turnout today. Thank you for being here. I want to first of all say thank you to Representative Michelle Dunphy. When we came to her and asked about sponsoring this bill, she took it up. She's been leading on it. We really appreciate her support and all of the other co-sponsors, and we hope eventually all of the other legislators in the state of Maine. I also want to give a shout out to MAFCA, who brought this bill along to where we are now. They did a great job of getting the word out about GMOs in this state and getting us a bill passed. It's a great bill, but it needs to be greater. I think we all agree that we don't really want to have to wait for New Hampshire. We've waited decades to have labels on these foods. Yeah. We don't want to wait for New Hampshire or any other state. So tell me, when would you like to see GMO labels on your food? Yeah. Great. That's what we thought. That's why we're here today. We would like to move this ball forward and get labels on food now. I just want to remind people, we're talking about food, and this always fascinates me. First of all, food brings us all together. Second of all, I love this issue because it brings so many people together. People from all political parties, from all backgrounds are interested in this food. We have across the country 90% at least support for labels on GMO foods. Here in Maine we have 97%. This is an issue that affects everybody, and more importantly, it affects, for me at least, because I'm, you know, getting up there, it affects my kids, and I have a beautiful 2-year-old granddaughter. This affects her. This is why we keep doing this, because we have future generations that are getting sicker and sicker and sicker, and we're finding out more and more that the reason they're getting so sick has a lot to do with what they're eating and a lot to do with what they don't know about what they're eating. So, really important issue, and I always like to remind people that while we're talking about food, the people who have put these genetically engineered crops, largely corn and soy and canola and a few others, into our food system are chemical companies. These are chemical companies, not food companies. They would love you to think that they care about farmers and they care about sustainability and that their food is so healthy, but these are chemical companies. And they invented GMO crops for the sole purpose of selling more chemicals. Those chemicals are now on our food, they're in our water, they're destroying our soil. The United Nations calls this 2015, has declared 2015 the International Year of the Soils. Our soil's in trouble because we're killing it with chemicals. And one last thing to remind everybody, I'm sure everybody here who turned out for this today knows this, but just last month, the top cancer researchers at the World Health Organization declared glyphosate, the key ingredient in Monsanto's Roundup, a probable human carcinogen. We allow this carcinogen on our food, and 84% of the crops, GMO crops in the market today, are grown with glyphosate. It's cancer causing. The EPA scientists back in 1985 said it was cancer-causing, and then under pressure from the industry, they reversed that decision. Now we're back right where we started. This stuff causes cancer. It's on our food. We need, at the very least, to have a label on our food. So thank you. Thank you to everybody. I see that we have some people from school, some younger people from... Let's give a shout out to them. This is why we do this. This is for them. Thank you, everybody, for being here. Thank you, Catherine. Okay, so We're here for the GMO labeling, and that's so important. But we're also here this afternoon is going to be heard of a bill, LD 783, which is a constitutional amendment to the state of Maine Constitution for the right to food. And here to speak about that is Heather Rettberg, who is on the board of directors of Food for Maine Future and also Local Food Rules. Hello, everybody. Thank you for coming out this afternoon. I just want to say, first of all, food is life, and the time is now. My name is Heather Rettberg. I'm here today because I eat food and I grow food. You'll have heard from others about food integrity and our right to know what is in the food that's grown or made for us by others. I'm a farmer, I'm a mother, but I eat food too, and I'm part of Local Food Rules, working towards community governance of our local food. I'm here today to speak to you about a right to food and a right to food of our choosing. I'm here today to speak about LD 783. This is a bill that seeks to add Section 25 to our Bill of Rights in Maine's Constitution. It states that every individual has a natural and unalienable right to food and to acquire food for that individual's own nourishment and sustenance by hunting, gathering, foraging, farming, fishing, or gardening, or by barter, trade, or purchase from sources of that individual's own choosing. And every individual is fully responsible for the exercise of this right, which may not be infringed. But why is that necessary? What does it mean to actually amend the Constitution, and how does that change our lives? First, I want to share something of the process so you all know just what we are actually asking the Agriculture Committee to do today. In order for the right to food to be a constitutionally recognized and protected right, LD 783 must first pass by a two-thirds majority of the legislature. So we need everybody to be talking to your representatives and your senators. We're not asking the representatives and the senators to put this in the Constitution. We're asking them to send it to us, the people, to vote on in the fall in a referendum. So what will it actually do? How will it change our lives? To understand the answer to these questions, we have to look first at what other rights the people of the state of Maine have declared and protected constitutionally. We have 24 articles in our Maine Bill of Rights. The first two will sound familiar to you. Natural rights. All people are born equally free and independent and have certain natural, inherent, and unalienable rights, among which of those are enjoying and defending life and liberty, acquiring, possessing, and protecting property, and of pursuing and obtaining safety and happiness. Section 2, power is inherent in people. All power is inherent in the people. All free governments are founded in their authority and instituted for their benefit, and they have therefore an unalienable and indefeasible right to institute government and to alter, reform, or totally change the same when their safety and happiness require it. So what does it mean to you in your daily life that you are born equally free and independent? That among your natural and inherent and unalienable rights, you can enjoy and defend your life and your liberty? What does it mean that you have the right to acquire and possess and protect property? That you can pursue and obtain safety and happiness? What does it mean that all power is inherent in the people? It means that the state of Maine recognizes all of the above as rights that no person or entity, no government or corporation, no one can strip away any of the above. And if someone, some agency, some corporation, or some government attempts to do so, you have standing in court under the highest order of law to defend yourself. No one can strip those rights away from you. A constitutionally declared and protected right lays out a legal foundation on which we can stand. Many of them are to protect us in case of aggression or hostility. So it still remains, why then do we need a right to food in our Constitution? You may have all heard these statements before, but they bear repeating. In 2010, the FDA stated that we have no absolute right to consume or feed our children any particular food. They said there is no deeply rooted historical tradition of unfettered access to foods of all kind, and the assertion of a fundamental right to their own bodily and physical health, which includes what foods they do and do not choose to consume for themselves, is unavailing because people do not have a fundamental right to obtain any food they wish. Did you know that? Did you know that there is no right to your own health, to choose what foods you feed yourself or your children? It's not legally protected. Our access to food, our right to life, our right to the founding of life, seed, is increasingly legally controlled by corporate food monopolies. And when they sue, the law is on their side. People lose. We lose our access to food integrity, to our own bodily and physical health. Unless we do otherwise. Establishing a right to food and a right to acquire food of our choosing gives us, the people, a legal grounding to protect our own health, our food, and our life. The right to food belongs with the other declared rights in Maine's Constitution. If we declare and protect this right, the strength of the law shifts away from corporate government control of food and life and toward people. I am so heartened that so many of you came out today urging the legislature to give us, to grant, to recognize the right to know what's in our food, but also to articulate the right to food. The time has come to place Section 25 in our Bill of Rights. Let us urge our legislators to embrace the opportunity to send this amendment to us so we can vote on it in the fall. Food is life. We have a right to it. Let us protect it and put the strength of law behind the people of the state of Maine.
Okay, folks, now the real work begins. I have no idea what time it is at this point.